Welcome to Nurse Educatrix. You're watching microbiology video series. Today's topic is hospital acquired infection. As we all know, our healthcare system contains a lot of microorganisms in and around the hospitals. So as a staff working there, we have to follow strict aseptic technique and infection control practice to prevent the patient from HAI. So if we see the introduction, as you all know that for the past few decades, hospitals have taken this HAI very seriously. So there are a lot of infection tracking and surveillance system running around the hospital management. The impact of the hospital acquired infection seen not just as an individual patient level, but also at the community level, they develop a lot of multi-drug resistant infections. These infections occur both in developed and as well as in developing country. If you see the statistics from the CDC, nosocomial infections accounts for 7% HAE in developed countries and 10% in developing countries. If you see the meaning and definition, the hospital acquired infection is synonymously used as healthcare associated infection and nosocomial infection. So all these three terms represents the same thing, that is hospital acquired infection. These are typically not present or might be incubating at the time of admission. For example, a patient got admitted in the hospital and during that admission time the patient was not having any signs of infection, and after 48 hours the patient is showing any kind of infection which is considered as hospital acquired infection. These infections are usually acquired after hospitalization and manifest 48 hours after admission to the hospital. So the word nosocomial is from Greek word, that is nosos means disease, comian means to take care. Reservoir or sources. So if you see what are all the sources or reservoir of nosocomial infection or HAI, they are nothing but the patient, the staff and the healthcare environment. So microflora of the patient is the first factor or sources of HAI, that is the endogenous flora, which is normal flora present inside the patient's body when there is circumstances develops like low immunity. The organism will start developing or producing an infection. Patient and staff. The patient themselves or the staff members working there, if they are not following strict infection control practice through direct contact like hands, saliva and other body fluids, the infection may transmit from one patient to another patient or one staff to patient. And when we what the third source is environment, it is healthcare environment like food, water and equipments which are present in the healthcare system itself will produce or may lead to infection. So these are all the three main reservoir or sources of HAI, that is microflora of the patient, that is endogenous flora present inside the patient, patient and the staff, and environment, that is healthcare environment. What are the types of nosocomial infections? The types have been classified by CDC as central line associated bloodstream infection, catheter associated urinary tract infection, surgical site infections and ventilator associated pneumonia. So what is central line associated bloodstream infection? This CLABSI so deadly nosocomial infection with a death incidence rate of 12% to 25%. So the patients who has central line catheter for fluid and medicine, if they are kept with the catheter for longer time, what happens? There is possibility of infection which transfer to the bloodstream, leads to blood septicemia. So if the handling of the catheter is not done properly by the staff nurses, or if the central line is kept for more days than the required period, what happens? There is possibility of bloodstream infections. The next is catheter associated urinary tract infections. CAUTI is the most usual type of nosocomial infections globally. So patients who were kept on the urinary catheter, they will have a chance of getting nosocomial infections. More than 12% of the reported infections are catheter-associated urinary tract infection as per the CDC. The catheter placed inside serves as a route of entry of bacteria. So if you are not following proper protocol or unnecessary insertion of the catheter or improper handling or hand hygiene leads to catheter associated urinary tract infection. The next is surgical site infection. It is SSIs. These SSIs or nosocomial infections fall in 2% to 5% of patients subjected to surgery. This is the second common type of nosocomial infection caused by Staphylococcus aureus. So this mostly results in put the patient under prolonged hospitalization and risk of death. So surgical site infections are less in percentage, but the problem is it makes the patient to stay in the hospital for a longer time and it develops a risk of death in some cases. The next is VAP, that is ventilator-associated pneumonia. VAP is nothing but the patient who were put on the ventilators. If they get a pneumonia due to the ventilator, we say it as ventilator-associated pneumonia. VAP is a nosocomial pneumonia found in 9 to 27% of patients on mechanical ventilators. So it is the highest percentage for patients who were on mechanical ventilation gets the VAP. It usually occurs within 48 hours after tracheal intubation. So once the endotracheal intubation is done, after 48 hours, they have a chance of getting VAP. 86% of nosocomial pneumonia is associated with the ventilation. So any patient gets a pneumonia after the intubation, mostly it's considered as nosocomial pneumonia or VAP. The signs of VAP is like fever, leukopenia and bronchial sounds, abnormal bronchial sounds, which are common symptoms of VAP. So you have to properly follow infection control practice and hand hygiene when you take care of patient with ventilators. Other than this commonly discussed types, we have noticed lot of common sites of infections like bacteremia, that is bacteria present in the blood, skin infections, respiratory tract, that is pneumonia, and surgical wounds, that is surgical site of infections, and urinary tract. If you see this pie graph, you know that UTI plays most of the circle. It means it has the highest percentage comparing to the pneumonia and surgical site infections, or equally having the ratio, and there is little chance of patient getting septicemia and skin infections and others. What is nosocomial pathogens? There are pathogens which are very commonly present in the healthcare environment. We call it as nosocomial pathogens. They all will be there, here and there, lying down. Once there is a chance for developing disease, they will start causing infection. So nosocomial pathogens are nothing but bacteria. Bacteria are the most common pathogens responsible for nosocomial infections like Staph aureus, Staphylococcus, and MRSA, ESBL, all those things comes under bacteria. Viruses, there are a lot of viruses which plays a role in nosocomial infection. Among 5% of all nosocomial infections are because of virus. So what are all the viruses? Most of them are hepatitis, HIV, rotavirus and herpes simplex virus. There are fungal parasites which acts as an opportunistic infection, causing nosocomial infection in immunocompromised individuals. Especially the fungal parasites, they wait for a chance. They are opportunistic infection. When the chance comes, they just develop into an infection. Aspergillus, candidiasis, candida albicans, cryptococcus, and of course we have mucormycosis now in COVID situation, where this fungal parasites causing black fungus. So these are all the agents of nosocomial infection, that is virus, bacteria and the fungal parasites. What are the common hospitals causing HAE? So if we see, all the invasive procedures leads to hospital acquired infection if it is not properly done, like nebulizer mask, which if it is not cleaned properly, catheterization, it is urinary catheterization as well as central line catheterization, whatever the catheter you are inserting inside the patient body should be done with sterile aseptic technique and should be handled in a aseptic techniques. IV procedures and dressing, even inserting an IV cannula may lead to nosocomial infections. Bedpans, when you use bedpans, urinals, so all these things has to be properly sterilized and cleaned and should be used. Dirty couch in the hospital reception also may lead to HAE. If you take a swab even in the wash sink or wash basin or in the hospital couch, if you take a swab, you will see staphylococcus aureus or streptococcus. So rise in HAE, mostly the reasons are crowded hospital conditions. When the hospital is crowded with so many people, the HAE possibility is more. New microorganisms are developing now which causes HAE. Increasing people with compromised immune system. Nowadays we have less compromised immune system in so many patients because of the chemotherapy or drug abuse and increasing bacterial resistance. So these are all some of the points why the HAE has been increasing or rising nowadays. There is crowded hospitals, new microorganisms are coming up, and people are with compromised immune system. They are not immune-wise strong to fight against the organisms. Increasing bacterial resistance because of wrong usage of antibiotics. Who are all the high-risk groups who may have a chance of getting HAE more? As premature babies, very sick children, elderly people, frail or fragile people or weak people, people with certain medical conditions like diabetes, and people with low immunity, that is like immunocompromised patients like HIV patients or patient under chemotherapy. All these people are coming under the high-risk groups. When you take care of patients with this high-risk group, you have to be more careful so that you will not introduce any new infection to them. What are the mode of transmissions? Here I haven't explained much about the mode of transmission. So it can be all the transmission types we can include in the HAE. It can be a contact, or it can be an airborne transmission, or oral route, or parenteral route, or vector-borne transmission. If the hospital has mosquitoes, of course the vector-borne transmission also happens. So all that mode of transmission comes under the HAE. Prevention of nosocomial infection. It is a very important aspect, especially for the nurses, because you should know how to prevent nosocomial infection so that we will not introduce any infection to new infections to the patients. So frequent hand hygiene is a very important and necessary thing. Every staff should do it, like hand hygiene with proper hand washing technique, proper use of PPE, that is personal protective equipment, appropriate antimicrobial use. As a doctor and a nurse, we should know proper use of antimicrobial therapy. Routine disinfection, that is cleaning of the hospital environment. Remove indwelling devices as early as possible. So when it is not necessary, immediately you have to remove any of the invasive lines, whether it is IV cannula or a urinary catheter. Unnecessarily, we are not supposed to keep it in patient. So all the standard precautions, what we discussed in the standard precaution video, comes under this prevention of nosocomial infection. So when a patient enters into the hospital, if you follow a strict standard precaution, of course, we can prevent most of the hospital acquired infection. So infection control procedures and policies it should be there, and we should adhere to those policies and procedures. Correct and frequent hand hygiene measures by all staff and patients. Keeping the healthcare environment and equipment clean. Complying with standard sterile techniques. Whenever you handle any invasive procedures, you should strictly adhere to sterile techniques. Using antibiotics appropriately to prevent and treat infection. So I have done the reference from Science Direct Journal and CDC government site. And these are all few questions for your knowledge. What are the preventive measures of CLBSI? Is it prolonged use of catheters, maintaining high level of aseptic technique, A and B, or none of the above? Give me the answer in the comment section. Factors influencing the nosocomial infections are patient susceptibility, microbial agent, environmental factors, all of the above. The third question here, it is, what are portals of entry of microorganism in intravenous catheter system? Insertion site, stopcock, medication port, all the above. So thank you for watching this video. We'll see you in next video.